So I can talk endlessly, but I hope with this many people in the room, people arrived with some kind of an agenda. With only 3 brief nights here, we'll have to cut to the chase. So if anyone came with any particular question in mind, this would probably be the moment to push to the front of the line. Yeah. These extremely exotic fields, solid-state physics and nanotechnology and gene transplant and all this stuff, they feel individually that complete breakthrough in their own field lies just 18 months, 2 years, 3 years in the future. They can see their technological and research dreams converging. But this enormous wavefront of knowledge that has risen up out of the context of human civilization, it doesn't communicate along the front of the wave. None of these people in any of these fields have a very clear grip on what's going on in the labs down the hall or 2 floors up in different departments. So what's happening is the human database has taken on a kind of self-organizing quality. It's no longer entirely being coordinated by political decision makers or corporate decision makers. It's just simply taken on a life of its own. And I've long thought that one way of thinking about what's going on this planet is that information is just simply bootstrapping itself to higher and higher levels of self-reflection and self-coordination using whatever means are necessary. When geology was all there was, that was the medium. When biology was all there was, that was the medium. When, chipped flint and ceramic was all there was, that was the medium. And now, the electronic information transfer technology is so all-pervasive that it's as though information has come into its own. I mean, it is now very restless in its relationship with biology as it explores, the new world of silicon into which it seeks to transform itself. I mean, technology has become prosthesis for the human species, and it's our machines and our technologies that are now the major evolutionary forces acting upon us. It's not our political systems. It's these extra-sexual children, these mind children that we have assembled out of the imagination. I find it very promising and very challenging and very interesting. I think that it is that somehow the way back to the archaic, to the world of ecological balance and low technology and retraction of toxic infrastructure and all of that good stuff, doesn't lie in some kind of Luddite know-nothingism or some kind of fascist program of limiting population and this sort of thing. Although I favor limiting population, I just can't figure out a way to do it that leaves human freedom intact. Instead, it has to be a forward escape, through technology, but technology that serves an agenda of archaic revivalism. My brother was just here this weekend, and after we presented publicly, then we spent a long night talking over all of this stuff. Between the spread of the information transfer technology, the internet and its promise of virtual reality soon to come, and biotechnology, which is literally taking apart the constituents of the living world and using them to produce all the drugs, all the foods, all the vitamins, all the nutritional supplements, and then many other solid-state materials between those two factors, and then nanotechnology, the technology of producing tiny machines made of diamond by the trillions, designed to do everything that nature does, so that cities can be grown like forests, and China can be fed out of matter compilers, and there is a complete break with the need with the agricultural cycle, so that the earth need no longer sustain the human population, and so then the human population, by breaking its reliance on the agricultural cycle, you know, then you gain some political breathing room. All of this is coming very, very fast, and is largely unanticipated by the political managerial types. What it means to me personally, I think, in terms of my own ideas about the future, is that I can now see, without too much sweat, from here to the eschaton in 10 easy steps. I mean, it's perfectly clear that if novelty is intensifying and locally concentrating, that where it's probably headed is into cyberspace or some kind of virtual space, so that, you know, long before 2012, the various ontologies of world religions will be peddled as theme parks in virtual space. And, you know, you'll be hard-pressed to know whether you're in heaven or simply in heaven land, which is, you know, a preview of heaven attainable by paying a $50 entrance fee at the turnstile. This is going to make it very difficult for all my predictions to be put in context, because they will be both true and untrue. Everything will come true in cyberspace. That's the whole idea. What cyberspace is, on one level, it's simply the human imagination vivified, hardwired. What we're doing furiously, as fast as we can, is exteriorizing the human nervous system into a global organism of some sort, in which has a weird kind of Husserlian intersubjectivity about it. You know, it is neither subjective nor objective. We are subjective nodes embedded in this domain of technologically created intersubjectivity between other human beings and machines. And what's happening is a lot of people are being left behind, or without even realizing it, are just opting out and saying, you know, I can't handle it, it's too much to think about, I think I'll see what's on daytime TV, or I'll buy a newspaper, or I'll walk in the park, to attempt to maintain the illusion that, you know, things are as they are. Things aren't as they are. Things have already become as they will be. The future is now not ahead of us. We're there. And the only question is, where do you position yourself now in this multidimensional matrix? You can deny it, which is to become a conservative, or at even more reactive to it, you can become a reprobate, if you wish, or you can move toward the front of knowledge, position yourself close to these unfolding and empowering technologies. as all notions of commodity and scarcity and this sort of thing begin, I say, to break down, it seems to me the sanest place to try and occupy in this whole situation is that of artist-producer, and that it's very, very important to not consume this stuff, that the world is being divided into artists and marks, to people who are like somehow initiated into a higher level maturity about what the society is about and how it works. It's a kind of street smarts, actually. And then the poor souls who just take it all for granted, you know, and actually are concerned about those families of Flight 800, the families, the agony of the families. You know, people so harebrained as to buy horse shit like that are going to have a very, very hard time as the crap game of the future unfolds to its full fury. So I think it's very important for people to define themselves as artists and learn tools and understand just how the game is being played in this informational jungle that is being erected, because you will either have a plan or you will become part of somebody else's plan, and there are a million plans out there waiting to ensnare the clueless. So more than ever, it becomes necessary to have some kind of anchor into a real modality. And, you know, it's too predictable for me to try and draw out the suspense. I mean, as far as I can tell, the only place where we can touch the earth in this evolving situation is through our bodies, into feeling by any means necessary, and that would certainly include psychedelics. The two books, or two very interesting books that I've read in the past year, and maybe some of you have read them, one is Morris Berman's Coming to Our Senses, and the other is David Abrams' book The Spell of the Sensuous. And both of these books are about feelings, essentially. And Whitehead, who I take as my mentor, you know, created a mathematically formal metaphysic in which the primary datum of experience is feelings. I mean, that's a direct quote from Whitehead. The only thing you can trust at this point, and some of you have heard me say this before, is the felt presence of immediate experience, otherwise known as feelings, and mathematics. And mathematics is something that most of you have been denied in order to keep you marks. So all you have are feelings. And so it's very important to empower this dimension, which Husserl or Merleau-Ponty or somebody called the felt presence of immediate experience. Everything proceeds from that. Even thought is subsequent to feeling, and still more removed is any hypothesis about reality and any theory of morality and any theory of action and so forth and so on. And so, you know, psychedelics, which have traditionally, I now think, played the role of deculturating people. I think the anthropologists got it slightly wrong. When you're taken out into the bushes and given some drug by the fellow members of your tribe, this is not that you are being made a full member of the society. It's that you were a full member of the society, and now what you're being shown is what's under the board, the tricks of the trade. You're being turned into not a full member of the society, but what my brother has called an extra environmental. You're coming from outside. And this is a kind of maturity that many people never, not only never attain, it never enters their mind that such a state even exists. A state not of alienation exactly, but of ironical, sophisticated insight into the mechanisms of one's own culture and the cultural games that are being played. And, you know, this rap would have been applicable at any time that it made sense, certainly any time in the 20th century. But with the rise of these technologies and the acceleration of all this novelty, it becomes more and more important to anchor it in this archaic value pattern accessible through psychedelics. And I don't say this with a sense of urgency. I think it's happening. I don't think there's a problem. I'm just sharing with you how I see it going. The people who are running the internet at the developmental and cutting edge level are very psychedelic. I mean, the connections are not lost, whether it's consciously or unconsciously apprehended. Somehow it can be sensed that the whole countercultural thrust since the 60s has been coherently one thing. It's about boundary dissolution and connectivity and strange pictures in your head, whatever that means. So it's the psychedelic experience from being a clandestine experience, and now I'm speaking of Western culture in the 20th century, from being a clandestine experience of an individual or of a caress is becoming the general model for the organization of global society. Whether anybody realizes it or not, this idea of all information in circulation, of a never-sleeping global mind with all... what's happening is that the unconscious mind is a luxury the human species cannot afford at this point in our dilemma. And so the unconscious mind is simply rising into consciousness by being hardwired into this global infrastructure. Well, so that's my take on it. What's your take on it? Does anybody want to say anything? Yeah.
I was wondering what this list of psychedelic plants was for in terms of, are there differences in one's experience with these, and are there ones that are more or less readily grown in one's backyard or greenhouse? Or,
oh yeah, well, it's
in common, what do they do to us?
It's a big issue. Yes, I mean, when I talk about psychedelics, I'm basically talking about alkaloids that occur in plant metabolism and have a history of human usage in Aboriginal shamanism. So that would be things like peyote, ayahuasca, mushrooms, certain snuffs, cannabis, datura, although daturas are not alkaloids. Or maybe they are, but the subfamily is tropane. Anyway, they're chemically different. The notion here is simply that there are a lot of problems with accessing altered states of consciousness, and many of these problems are artificially induced by frightened governments restricting access. So it's slowly dawned on people that these chemicals occur in most environments, in many plants, and with a little chemical strategy and a little cookery and a little shamanic strategy, out of most environments you can coax some kind of kick-ass consciousness-altering plant or combination of plants without resort to the local criminal syndicalists who may be prowling the streets. So it's sort of become a I don't know, I don't want to demean it, but a fad, a hobby, an avocation of people to grow these plants. If you want me to recommend one that might get you off, not kill you, and keep you out of jail, well, the one that we're all very interested in at the moment is Salvia divinorum. Salvia divinorum is a plant that for years was carried in the psychedelic literature as possibly hallucinogenic, but nobody could get off on it. It's a mint that grows in the mountains of Mexico. And then a few years ago, an anthropologist, Brett Blosser, some of you probably know Brett, he's been to Esalen, he was studying these Mazatec Indians and finally just put it to them, and they took him off in the bushes and, you know, got him so loaded that he was raving about it. So then the chemists moved in. The chemists had visited the situation before, but with a simple alkaloid test. You know, you have this thing called Dragendorf's reagent, and you mash it up with a plant, and if it turns color, it's got alkaloids. Well, you do this in the field. Well, they had tested Salvia divinorum, and it was negative for alkaloids, so having never encountered a psychedelic that wasn't an alkaloid, they felt confident in rejecting it. Once these reports began to come in, they went back through, and in fact, it was an underground chemist. I'm not sure he wants his name stated, but anyway, again, someone, a frequent visitor to Esalen. And he went back and, with quite simple procedures, lo and behold, out comes a crystalline white powder. And he, following the famous example of Albert Hoffman with LSD, that you should start 100 times smaller than you think is where the action is, he smoked 1 milligram, 1,000 mics. I mean, that's a grain of salt of this stuff. And, you know, completely lost it. And so then he went back and discovered that years previously there had been analysis done on this plant, and that a compound called alpha-salvinorine had been isolated and characterized, but never given to test animals or human beings. So he sent for a chromatographic standard of this compound, and immediately smoked it up upon arrival. And it did exactly what the stuff he'd gotten out of the plant had done to him. So then he knew that the compound in the plant was alpha-salvinorine, a diterpene, a compound in a chemical family previously unknown to contain psychoactive material. And word spread, and people smoke this, roll bombers out of the dried leaves, put quids of the fresh leaves in their mouths, and then in some vanishingly small few cases of the truly intrepid, people have extracted the stuff to crystal and smoked it. I don't urge you to do that. I mean, 500 micrograms of this stuff. This is the first compound found in nature active at that range. I mean, LSD is active at 500 micrograms, but it was thought for decades to be the only drug active at that range. I mean, somebody once said to me, you want to know what a human being getting loaded on 500 micrograms of LSD is like? He said, that's like one red ant ripping apart the Empire State Building in 40 minutes. You know, I mean, it's dramatic that such a little bit of material can do what it does. Well, this stuff in Salvia Divinorum is in the ballpark, definitely. And, you know, DMT test pilots return white-knuckled and ashen from whatever it is that lies on the other side of this stuff. As a plant, you know, the good news is it's easy to grow. It's easy to grow enough to take. It's not illegal. It is not illegal to grow, extract, transport, advocate, use in therapy. It's just simply not illegal in any way. It'll be very interesting to see how the establishment handles this particular compound, because this is not the 1960s when you can just, the way the drug laws are written, for something to be made illegal at the pleasure of the Attorney General or someone like that, it has to be a structural near relative of an already illegal compound. And this isn't. This isn't. So the only way this stuff could be made illegal is for scientific evidence to be brought into court that there's something wrong with it. And causing hallucinations at this point, I don't think, is enough. It has to. There has to be some physical toxicity or some demonstrable public health problem, or this will probably get through. I think really what salvia means, and then there are others I could talk about, but this isn't a psychobotany gathering, or maybe it is. But I think what all this means is that the drug laws are not going to be repealed. They're just simply going to become irrelevant because there are so many loopholes, chemical exceptions, local sources of every illegal thing. I mean, take DMT, for example. DMT is a Schedule I drug, heavily controlled, but since all those laws were passed, it's come to be realized that every human being has it in them. Well, so you're holding. You are potentially arrestable for holding and transporting a Schedule I drug. Well, then that's obviously absurd, but on the other hand, the law has never been fought on those grounds. So ayahuasca is a perfect example. In a sense, ayahuasca is not a drug because everything in it that is working occurs in the human body anyway, just in smaller amounts and in a different ratio. So, you know, unless we propose to make human brains illegal, which, you know, I'm sure there are some people who would line up for that with great enthusiasm, but I think that's Buchanan's 17% that we just have to put up with. Most people realize, I think, that the chemistry of consciousness and the chemistry of nature are co-evolved and equally complex, and the place where one stops and the other begins is a fool's game. So if any of you are interested, salvia, you know, it's easy to sit here. I mean, talking about psychedelics is very, 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 very different from taking psychedelics. It's all very well to listen to me spiel my spiel, but the most important thing you could possibly do is actually somehow contort the contents of this evening to the point where it got you loaded. And that's probably best approached legally, safely, horticulturally, humbly, through Salvia Divinorum.
How long does that experience last?
Well, the way I like to do it, people do it different ways. The way I like to do it is I weigh about 35 grams of it, which is quite a pile, and then I remove the vein, the mid-vein of the leaf, with my fingernail, just to drop the volume down. And then when it's all done, I have this very nice soft pile of green leaves. And then I roll it up and fold it up and put it in my cheek and lie down where I can see a digital clock. And what I'm waiting for is minute 17 or so. And right around then, you know, you get visual streaming. Purple and chartreuse blobs of light floating past your eyes. This is not the psychedelic experience. It's the prodrome of hallucination. You sometimes see this after orgasm. But in the case of the salvia thing, after 2 or 3 minutes of this, it doesn't go away. Instead, it, you know, moves on to the next level. And this is extremely peculiar plastic stretching, folding, machine-like hallucinations. It reminds me, some of you may know, Salvador Dali's painting, Ode to the Revolution No. 5, construction, soft construction in baked beans. Do you know that painting?
Yeah.
Well, yes, it's like that, and you sort of feel like that. And the hallucinations are very bright. They are not... Like, what I always think when it's happening is, my God, I can't believe this stuff is legal. It actually is working, you know. It's not like it's almost working or sort of working or any of these, you know, with these other horrible legal things. This one works. It works. And it works enough that that you actually reach a place with it where you wonder if it's not going to work too much, which tells you just how good it is. Of course, at that point, you're probably at the top of the mountain, just as you begin to have anxiety about, well, how strange will this be? You're probably coming around the corner. And then you come down in about 45 minutes and go to sleep.
Total time being?
An hour. Mm-hmm.
Rather interesting hour.
If it didn't taste so bad, I could do it 3 nights a week. In other words, I don't know exactly how to explain it. It is absolutely satisfying and very powerful, but it doesn't seem at that dose. It doesn't seem like it could become a wild horse. At higher doses, the stories begin to get harder to map. And people who fiddle with the pure compound are obviously really intrepid. It seems to be about some kind of... My brother described it very well the other night. He seems to be susceptible to it. Some people are and some aren't. And he was at a conference somewhere and there was just dried material rolled. And he just took a big hit basically to see how it tasted, to sort of get the feeling for how it tasted. And it folded him. I mean, he came apart. He twitched on the ground, and his description of it was, he said it was like being rotated to the left. There was this strange counterclockwise twist, and then you're like in this other dimension. You've just been hyperdextrorotary homogenized, and now you're in a previously unsuspected domain of space and time that is immediately contingent to this dimension, but only by that means. And people do, people talk about something folds, something twists or untwists. There's definitely a sense of being moved. That's how, and the come on is faster than DMT, which is hard to imagine. I mean, the come on, in fact, is so fast that you sort of discover yourself there. You know, you're waiting for it to come on, and then you realize that for some time it has actually been on, and it was your perceptions that were lagging.
Is it nauseating?
No. I mean, the taste, if you do it, the fresh leaf in the mouth, it tastes very much like a very large mouthful of very leafy leaf. It's bitter. It's bitter. But it's not appalling. It's just bitter. One could probably get used to it, you know.
After the 17 minutes, do you spit it out or do you keep it in your mouth?
Well, I used to tell people to spit it out at minute 17, and then some people couldn't, there were complaints. And so now what I tell people is keep it in your mouth until it works. But some, unless you're a hard case, somewhere between 15 and 20 minutes, it's going to find you. Yeah.
Two things. One, going back, is where do you see technology? Do you see technology playing a game in the altered state of consciousness? And reading about superstring theory and probabilities, etc., and listening to you, I can't help but make this connection of these altered states being shifted into just a slightly less probable place than us being here now. And what is your take on that?
Well, first of all, how technology relates to altered states, on a trivial level, but on a obvious level, I guess, it's really knitted the community together. I mean, the internet empowers all marginalia, and God knows we're marginal. So the fact that there are these conferences and email lists where people feel free to say anything and to pass on all kinds of botanical, chemical, shamanic information means nobody need now get into trouble through ignorance, because there are vast FAQ files on the net, and if you've gotten some DMT and you're wondering what it does, there's an afternoon's worth of reading on the internet. You know, Gracie and Zarkov take a trip, McKenna meets the basketballs, and on and on and on. So that's very important. But as I said, somewhat pedestrian. The thing that excites me about these informational technologies is I think we're going to be able to use virtual reality to show each other the insides of our own heads, and that this has never been possible. I mean, we know each other by our surfaces and our symbols. You know, we make small mouth noises and we assume we share the same dictionary, and by such rickety infrastructure as this, we build community and understanding. But if everybody worked on the mansion of their soul in cyberspace, and you could invite people in and say, you want to know who I am? I'm not this 6-foot, 2-inch piece of meat. That's not it. Here's what it is. Here's my hopes, my dreams, my fears, my past accomplishments, my unfinished projects, my catastrophes. Incredible amount of intimacy, and hence mutual appreciation and empathy. So I think the whole thing is bandwidth. Bandwidth simply means on one level it means the speed at which information is moved from one point to another, but in experiential terms, what bandwidth means is how deep the image is. You know, a telephone call is very low bandwidth. A television-assisted telephone call is higher bandwidth. And as we expand bandwidth between each other, we will dissolve our differences. I mean, this is my faith. I think it's amazing that we've built a global civilization in an environment of 4,000 languages and no better mode of communication than small mouth noises and their electronic equivalents. And so we're about to take an enormous leap toward understanding each other. What we will understand, I don't know. A friend of mine who was somewhat speaking ironically, but I think he meant it, said, all decadence is finding out what the neighbors are really doing. You know, that what society is an elaborate structure to keep us believing certain things about each other, which are in fact not true. And that when we find out they're not true, then we're going to have to deal with that. Imagining what these truths might be is food for thought, certainly. So virtual reality, you know, we'll show each other the inside of our heads and our dreams, and then my own private obsession. I hope we can see simulations of psychedelic states. I mean, this is where all this graphics creativity and three-dimensional graphics power, and because anybody who has taken psychedelics much at all knows that there are realms of beauty in there more astonishing than the Sistine Chapel or, well, I don't know, Angel Falls for that matter. I mean, the most beautiful things in the universe are inside the human mind. And, you know, I was trained at one point as an art historian, and if art is the effort to get those mental objects into the shared world of social space, then art has a lot of catching up to do. I mean, the very best art has been a very halting. You know, you discover more art in your own head than the entire canon of Western art since the Renaissance. And who are we? Just ordinary people. So it will be immensely empowering. The question about superstring theory, I don't claim to understand it. I also suspect that fashion is now rules the physics department, and it's all changing so quickly. You know, physics has all, for 200 years or 150 years, physics was the paradigmatic science. All sciences aspired to be as scientific as physics, because often in physics, theory and experimentally derived values will agree with each other out to 5 or 6 decimal points of measurement. Well, God, in sociology, if you get within 10%, you hail yourself as rigorous. So, and biology sort of falls in between there, but is very sloppy compared to physics. But physics is, once they pushed beyond the Hamiltonian model of the atom and into the domain of the quanta, the phenomena that are encountered are so counterintuitive that nobody knows exactly how to interpret it. I mean, the people who actually do the work of quantum physics on a daily basis work in a pure mathematical language and actually make a considerable effort not to try and think about what does this mean in English, because it means stuff so crazy that you can't even... that it's just so counterintuitive. I mean, for instance, a month ago in Science News, they reported, what was it, a beryllium atom that they were able to excite into this peculiar quantum state where, as far as any test they could tell, it was in two places at one time. Well, was it in two places at one time, or is it that English is simply inadequate to say what it was, and this is some kind of deceiving lower dimensional description of it? Non-locality is this phenomenon that was thought so squirrely and improbable that in the 20s, when they formulated the quantum theory, they had two quantum theories on the table in front of them, both giving identical predictions mathematically, but using different assumptions. And one of them had non-locality built into it, and the other had uncertainty built into it. And they thought uncertainty was a smaller outrage to reason than non-locality. So they chose the Heisenberg-Bohr model with this uncertainty principle embedded in it. But now, in the last 5 years, non-locality, which previously was just this, it was sort of a joke that these equations predicted non-locality, but some people thought up experiments to actually test this, and non-locality is as experimentally verifiable as any other phenomenon in the quantum world. And what does it mean? It means that all matter in the universe is somehow connected to all other matter in the universe instantaneously, without subject to the inverse square law or the speed of light. And, you know, this essentially vindicates mysticism, which has been at loggerheads with the enterprise of Western science since it began. It also may mean, you know, the alchemists like to say, what is here is everywhere, what is not here is nowhere. What it implies, it potentially, is that all information is immediately available, that we need not go to the Andromeda galaxy or the moons of Jupiter or anywhere else to find out the answer to any question. Somehow information is holographically and fractally and homogeneously distributed through the space-time matrix. Well, God, if you could get a technology together based on that, it would be the greatest revolution since the birth of human language or something like that. Yeah.
I suspect that life is a great enough technology to be able to...
Yeah, I suspect so too. One of the things I mentioned, and one of the things
I worry about, if I have a concern about the machine part or the hard wiring, is that it can take the attention away from
the biological,
my being able to do that, you know, which may mean needing the help of some other minds and stuff also to be able to kind of reach that.
Well, I think technology, the human brain is the god of technological innovation. In other words, we want to do it that way. We want to do it that small, that fast, that neatly. So as technology advances, it's going to look more and more like biology. Nanotechnology, which, as you all probably know, is this evolving technological field where you work with single atoms. You build up things atom by atom. Well, this is how biology does it. DNA is read by ribosomes that specify the assembly of proteins atom by atom. This is how we will do it. So the technologies of the future will be more and more quote-unquote natural appearing. And finally, my fantasy is, you know, a world where when you want to contact the internet, you just walk over and put your hand on a tree, and you immediately have T6 connection to the global bio-cybernetic matrix in cyberspace. Everything that we're doing, like building the internet, for example, You can build the internet, you can lay fiber optic cable everywhere and put up space satellites or stuff like that, but another way to do it would just recognize that the mycelial network already present in the soil probably has room for you to run your messages through it while it's doing the business of being alive. So, you know, the telephones of the future may look more like mushrooms than they do today. I mean, by nature is obviously the model. And see, our technology now is a technology of heavy metals, high temperatures. I mean, we weld things, we melt things, and when we build, we assemble pieces of things, and then we bring them together under high pressure and high heat to make automobiles and aircraft and this sort of thing. Nature, notice that nature, meaning organic nature, not volcanoes and hot springs, but organic nature accomplishes all of her miracles under 115 degrees Fahrenheit. There's no welding of beryllium and this sort of thing. So we could do that too. And when you use cool temperatures like that, well, then you don't generate toxic gases and strange physical byproducts like sulfur dioxide and mercuric oxide and all of this toxic material. So the machine age as we have known it was simply a very brief episode in human beings' relationship to the construction of prosthesis. I mean, I more and more think of it that way. I mean, the touching a tree to get to the internet, that's pretty far out. I mean, in other words, there are steps to that that we don't know how to take. But I've talked at other times to this group about what I call these black contact lenses, except they're not contact lenses, they're actual implants in the back of your eyelids, so that when you close your eyes, there are menus hanging in space. That's not even nanotechnology. That's doable today. I mean, it might cost $1 billion, but if it were a fighter plane, we could deliver it in 6 years. It's easily done. So what I hope will happen is that we will retract this bulky, toxic, archaic, industrially based infrastructure and become more and more aboriginal in our presentation to an observer, but in fact through implants, prosthesis, nanocytes crawling around on the surface of our skin and inside our bodies and in the environment and so forth and so on, we will actually be becoming at the same time that we make our peace with nature, we will continue to technologically evolve toward whatever it is that we are evolving toward. I don't understand what it is. What did you make of it? I mean, that's the basic question. What do you make of this?
Well, someone asked me to explain what you talked about, or what psychedelics, I guess in a sense I was trying to say something, and about how I feel, why would I come back today to listen to you?
Uh-huh.
It wasn't a sense of hope, but it's more of a sense of understanding, deepening of some sort of understanding of, like, sometimes I'll contemplate, well, how come, I know what I was saying. I was saying that, how come humans think that they're more aware than the whole rest of the everything else. And I was sitting at the squatting down on the bath floor with a squirrel, I guess giving him a nut, and I was eating a nut, and we were just both there eating nuts and looking at each other eating the nuts. And I thought,
I've noticed a lot of squirrels in the band.
Yeah, it's because of the cornmeal. That's partly my...
I should have known.
But it's like, I felt like we were all just sitting there, eating nuts together, and we're on the same level. And we're, like, I was raising my eyebrows, going, good nuts, you know. And the squirrel was like doing this thing with his jaw, you know, I guess it doesn't have eyebrows, you know, kind of answering back. And my thought was, well, the whole part of, like, psychedelics is you start to feel like you're in oneness with all the other atoms around, whether it's a tree or rock or, you know, another human being or an animal or whatever. And it's that feeling of oneness that rather than that thinking, oh, I'm more conscious than anybody, all the other animals on the planet, that you go, aha, and you feel really good about. And that's kind of that same that feeling with psychedelics is you feel more connected with everything. And so in a sense, all of a sudden I thought, well, maybe this is a flip back. You know, now we take psychedelics and we feel the separation of, oh, yes, I'm more of higher consciousness rather than the original, which was the union with everything or something.
Well, one of the things my brother mentioned this weekend to me was the idea that maybe we could come to a place where every eye that looks out at nature had intelligence behind it. And the concept of human intelligence, you know, that dead song, you are the eyes of the world. If we could somehow disperse intelligence into nature. I mean, maybe this is what the human mission is to bring intelligence into focus and then somehow give it back and awaken the natural world, not to say that it isn't awakened. Who can presume to know? One of the nice things about being in Manhattan is you never have to worry that you're the smartest person in the room, because you never are. You know, in other places you might be able to get this together through intense social management, but there it fails, sort of like being in a rainforest in that sense.
I was intrigued with some of the things you just mentioned in passing, like seeds from which cities would grow, and want to know where I could learn more about those ideas. That's pretty out there.
Well, visit Eric Drexler's webpage or read his book, The Engines of Creation. This idea that, the O's, which we talked about last night, were bio, techno, nano. I don't think we talked about fungo, but we certainly could. Spaghettios, Cheerios. Nanotechnology is moving so quickly, not because the army wants it or capitalism wants it. It's moving so quickly because all the best people refuse to work on anything else simply because it's so cool. And, you know, why you should have 10,000 steam engines on a 1-centimeter chip, and what can you do with a steam engine that produces 1/10,000th of a millinewton of force and costs, you know, 0.0 mil to produce, it remains to be seen. I mean, it's an entirely different way of thinking about what machines are. I mean, not only, as I talked about last night, getting away from toxic high temperatures, but just the power over matter that represents is some kind of arrival at the end of a long technological road that we've been pursuing since the first flint was chipped maybe 500,000 years ago. The holy grail of nanotechnology is this thing called a matter compiler. And a matter compiler does to matter what an SGI indigo does to graphic images. In other words, anything you can imagine. And it builds three-dimensional objects essentially out of air, out of mud, out of slurry, seafloor, some rich, heavy metal-rich slurry of material is coming into this thing, and out of it are coming sewing machines, mandarin oranges, bicycles, electronic components, spaghettios, and in Neil Stephenson's novel, The Diamond Age, rice. They're feeding China out of matter compilers. That's what I referred to last night when I said how revolutionary it would be to break the human agricultural cycle, and what a relief this might be for the earth if we didn't have to produce our food by agricultural methods. Vast amounts of the earth could be reclaimed or turned fallow. There have been revolutions like this before that have forestalled human and ecological catastrophe. For example, cities themselves, the decision of human beings about 10,000 years ago to aggregate very tightly into fixed settlements probably gave the earth a great deal of breathing room for a long time. If we had continued with our system of nomadic pastoralism, it required thousands and thousands of square miles to support very small populations. So in a sense, there have been in the past episodes where we took steps to slow our impact on the environment. One of the funny things that emerges out of nanotechnology, from my point of view, is, you know, I'm very gung-ho for the idea that there isn't much time left, and that 2012 represents this huge phase shift, and it's only now 16 years away. But a funny thing, with nanotechnology, you can stretch time by a factor of a million. Even though 2012 is only 16 years away, with the correct technological approach, we can forestall it forever by simply scaling down, you know, scaling down, so that when you live in the domain and at the speed of microbes, 16 years is 50 million generations in the distant, far-flung future. Weird how time is plastic and subject to scale in that way.
What is it about you're focusing on?
If what the universe is doing is generating and then conserving and then novelty and then building further novelty upon it, well then in some sense we represent the novelty of novelties of novelty. We are where nature's eggs have tended to all roll to the bottom of the basket, and we're it. And so then our role in transforming the planet, the ecosystem, our social systems and technologies and everything becomes much more part of a cosmic drama, a continuation of the evolutionary drama. And then the question... But the really weird part of this whole rap is the nearness of this date. I think you could peddle this pretty easily if you were just vague about the date and said something like, sometime in the next 1,000 years. And then people would see who couldn't line up for that. Mm-hmm. It's this, it is now thing, sort of the guy with the beard on the corner, repent and be saved. I don't know what led into that, but time is a very interesting problem and not well dealt with, I think, in Western science. Probability theory is very fuzzy. And as the answers required or the questions asked in science become more precise, it becomes less satisfying. Albert, are you ready to go here?
No, I'm just...
Launch when ready.
No, I'll ask you sort of a query. Just sort of tying back to something you were talking about with the nanomachines, you were saying that we could sort of stretch out time by scaling down. And the fact that sort of this great thing that was going to happen in 2012, you know, it was okay. That's the flavor. But it was okay because we could sort of scale time up for us. We could learn to stretch it out. I'm just curious, and I'm bringing this up again, or going back to this just because it sounds relevant, how time can be stretched out in that way that you... If you could talk more about that. Is it just about more events happening?
Well, that's one thing. It's just simply more events happening. In other words, at that nano-level, activity is so furious that in terms of events per second, there are millions of them at the quantum mechanical level, but there is a deeper level than that, and that is the attractor in the phase space, if in the novelty theory, is somewhat like a black hole. Well, a black hole has this thing called an event horizon, and so if to an observer exterior to the system, let's think of a spaceship approaching a black hole, to an observer outside the system, the spaceship appears to eventually disappear down the drain and is sucked into the hole. But because of relativistic stretching inside the hole, for the people on the spaceship, essentially, they fall forever. They never reach. They never move beyond the event horizon. And so time is very plastic and slippery, and you cannot assume that what one observer is assuming is general for the system. That's why, you know, I'm very sort of tongue-in-cheek about all these apocalyptic prophecies and when we get there and what will it be like and those kinds of questions, because it is a singularity, it's bound to be hideously slippery and difficult to actually confront. So falling forever, like for instance, one way to think of the time wave, because it, and for the group I'll say, the assumption that is operating in novelty theory is that you have a series of nested cycles, and that each cycle is 1/64th as large as the cycle that preceded it. So let's say we start, just for purposes of example, with a universe that whose age is 72 billion years. That's a lot longer than is thought to be the age of this universe, which is somewhere between 12 and 16 billion years. They're fighting over it now in the captain's tower. But let's imagine a universe of 72 billion years with a built-in collapse factor of 64 and a nested set of cycles of natural law. Well, then 1.8 divide 72 by 64, and it's a number like 1.3 or something. So 1.3 billion years before you got to the end of this 72 billion year universe, there would be a transition into a new regime of natural law. Maybe it's biology. Well, then divide 1.3 billion years by 64 and you get, I don't know what, let's take a guess, 275 million years. Well, that's the, and so a new set of emergent phenomena come into the picture at that point. Let's call them advanced higher animals, land animals. Well, then the next cycle is 1.4 million years. Well, that's, or 2.5 million years. Well, so let's call that the emergence of the higher primates. And the next is 175,000 years. Let's call that the emergence of Homo sapien. And the next is 4,500 years. Let's call that the history of the world. And the next is 67 years. Let's call that World War II to 2012, and the next is 384 days, and that's the year of the jackpot that begins late in 2011. Now, notice that at this point, we have gone through six or seven levels. In order to get to the domain of Planck's constant, 6.55 times 10 to the minus 23rd erg seconds, technically known as a jiffy, in order to get down to the realm of the jiffies, which is the grain of the universe in quantum mechanical terms, it's going to take 13 more involutions of that cycle. So what we're saying is a universe structured like this, with this collapse factor in it, a universe 72 billion years old would undergo two-thirds of its morphological unfolding. In other words, two-thirds of its developmental processes would occur in the last 6 days of its existence. Do you see what it is? It's the spin-in. It spins faster and tighter. So half of the evolutionary unfolding of that kind of universe would occur in the last few days of its existence. Most of it would occur in the last few milliseconds as it transited level after level after level. That's the kind of situation that I think we're in. And each epoch becomes a dimension for the expression of feeling and complexity in some kind of Whiteheadian sense. Each one of these is in and of itself a universe of feeling and intentionality in the history of the universe as it makes its way toward the point singularity where all things are cotangent and all limitations are overcome. So trying to feel where we are in that process, saying there are only 16 years left is one way of thinking of it. Another way of thinking of it is that the universe still has two-thirds of all of its development ahead of it in the future. Does that address your thing?
Yeah, no, that's helpful. Thank you. I'm curious if you have any ideas about what happens at that singularity. I mean, does time lose meaning? Is it just kind of like asking the question, what is the point south of the South Pole? Yeah, I mean, I'm just curious what happens to time at that point. Is there something like 2013, or are we just sort of in a... I mean, what I guess I could imagine is that just because...
Well, it seems to me what happens is that this cotangentiality phenomenon is happening now. In other words, what's happening is that three-dimensional space and time is becoming more and more connected. Everything is becoming more connected. Well then, so the logical extrapolation of that process is that you will approach a point in time where everything is connected to everything else. Well, so then the question becomes, or the question that's being asked is, what happens after that? And I think the answer is that the process of connectivity somehow bursts out of the dimensional confinement, and then you get an entry into hyperspace, whatever that means. In other words, the information has filled the system. And somehow then it bursts the bounds of the system in some kind of, you know, a Gödelian explosion of some sort. And then it begins to define itself in a higher dimension. And life, we see that nature does this. We just can hardly imagine what it is like to experience it, A, and what it is like in a regime of conscious intelligence. One thing that I've thought about, trying to imagine all this happening without, you know, the direct descent of God Almighty into the stream of history and such imponderable and difficult to picture scenarios as that, is there something that could arise out of us which would fulfill this? And somehow everybody could say, yeah, well, they were right and that did happen, but nevertheless, we can still, you know, have sausage for breakfast. Well, one thing that I've thought of, and I've talked in these groups about it a little bit, is what the vicissitudes of the wave seem to describe most accurately when all the shouting is done is technological and intellectual advance. And so is it possible that this bursting out of the Newtonian three-dimensional space-time continuum could be a technological breakout? And it could take the form of a very, very powerful engine of some sort, like that could push a large mass close to the speed of light. But more appealing and easier to understand, I think, is a time machine. It occurs to me that there may be something else happening here. And again, to understand it, here's a metaphor. Notice that we live in an extremely high-tech world with the internet and, you know, potential AIDS vaccines and interplanetary probes and all that. But some people in this world are bare-ass naked in the rainforest trying to decide if they're going to go with boats, which they've been observing and have now decided are here to stay. Well, if you ask the question, who's influencing who? Clearly, we have an overwhelming influence on these rainforest people. Their lifestyles are crumbling under an onslaught of transistor radios, packaged food, pornography, blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, I don't see anything happening around here except maybe an occasional shaman is brought through that indicates that they're having much of an impact on us. Well, so imagine if it were possible to have a technology of time travel. I think that what would happen in that case is that what one would think of as time travel would instead turn into a technology for causing the rest of history to happen instantly. In other words, to avoid all of these paradoxes, you would initiate, you know, the temporal equivalent of a chain reaction, and the rest of history would just unravel on the reel very quickly. So that the most technologically advanced state would spread backward through the temporal medium in the same way that the most advanced cultural state in the world today is spreading through the spatial medium of the planetary geography. Do you see what I mean? It's a kind of a God whistle. You think you're building a time machine, but what you discover the moment you turn the time machine on is that you have brought the final evolutionary achievement of the universe appears right on your front step in the next millisecond. Yeah.
We were talking about dissipative structures before, and how I understood it is that you're taking like negative entropy in it, more structure, but you give waste out all the time too. And if you see the globe or like all the human societies on the earth like a dissipative structure, there needs to be the waste somewhere, like, and you need to create a distance between these structured systems and the waste somewhere around. And I wonder how you put that together with your theory of time or of novelty.
Well, the entire planetary environment is an open system because it's being run off extraterrestrial energy delivered by the sun. If it weren't for the sun, the Earth would quickly go into a crisis. There is no problem with the generation of waste as long as the generation of waste cycle doesn't exceed the capacity of the system to absorb it. And this is our problem. Not that we produce waste, but that we produce it too fast. One of the things my brother pointed out was if you really believe nanotechnology is coming, then the shrewdest investment that you can make are landfills. Because landfills are filled with metal, glass, plastic, rare elements, rare chemicals, all these things which these little nanosites, these flea-sized and smaller robots, are going to go after. I mean, those will be the great mining and extraction sites of the future, quite logically, because you'll be using all of that material. It's already in a highly refined state. In fact, the great thing about nanotechnology is because these machines are so small, the current standing crop of metals presently on the Earth is probably enough for the rest of human history. If it's a nanotechnological history, there would be no need to extract more gold, more platinum, more iridium. We have enough for nanotechnological purposes, probably by orders of magnitude we have enough. The point, see, the goal is to take nature as the model and to say, okay, we want to build things. Well, who's been building longest? Nature. Who's been building most efficiently? Nature. Who's been building with the least toxic output and so forth and so on? Nature, nature, nature. So we are builders. So let us learn then from the master builder. And of course, until we can do it perfectly, we will do it imperfectly. But more perfectly than we're doing it now. We finally at last sort of sighted what the deal is with building stuff. Oh, it's supposed to be biodegradable, non-toxic, user-friendly, nutritious, brightly colored, you know, whatever. And so the way nature does it is atom by atom. And using, you know, molecular long-chain polymers with molecular transcription to run through ribosomes which read these things. I mean, as you descend into the molecular and the submolecular realm, it becomes startlingly machine-like. I mean, nature is the perfect machine. There is no difference. Our machines are hideous. And, you know, run at high temperatures, are toxic.
That's part of the question I have is, you know, nature's already made, like, you put this little seed in the ground and it turns into a huge tree, and how can we improve on that? It seems like it's already a perfect system that's been developed.
Well, it is a perfect system developed for the ecosystem in which it inserts itself. I mean, it's a product of evolution. We, by being minded, we can use the techniques of nature to serve the design agendas of culture or of human society. That's the difference. I mean, really, my vision is of a partnership. I talked last night about what I called the forward escape, where there's no way back to simplicity, not without slaughtering four out of all five people. You know, I mean, even a billion people is too much. There's no way back to the simplicity that we once knew, but there may be a way forward to the simplicity that we once knew. But we have to become fully responsible and entirely capable, you know, not half responsible and half capable, which is the present situation. Capability means power, immense power, but power means responsibility. In other words, we can't evade the curious moral dimension that attends our enterprise, given the fact that we are conscious beings. But we can be responsible. Like my notion is, really, in a sense, the human imagination, which is our great glory, has grown so powerful that we can barely unleash it on the surface of the planet. I mean, it's like trying to drive a fire truck around the nursery. The nursery can't handle this. The nursery is small and confined. So responsibility means respecting nature, but also making a place for the novelty that is resident in the human possibility, because nature also did that. I mean, nature risked everything on this planet, on this particular experiment. And I imagine nature is well pleased. I mean, we're as successful as everything else nature ever attempted to do. I mean, when she wanted to make octopi, she made them. When she wanted to make machine-building, neurotic, tormented human beings, she made them in spades.
Well, what if something like the Cultural Revolution in China were to occur? There you had a group of people who decided to destroy everything that was old and traditional in that culture. What if humans came to the point where they realized that all our technology was so grossly unsatisfying that we just kind of went on some kind of rampage to destroy everything that was modern and technological in some kind of self-destructive mode in order to get back to a more nature-based, satisfying lifestyle?
Well, this could probably be done, but I would bet you that as soon as people picked themselves up off the floor, they'd start the long march forward again. Because I think tool making is, you know, what we do. And it's just irrepressible. We are the creature, you know, in the same way that abalones make abalone shells, we construct technologies. It's irrepressible, I think. I mean, it might take different directions. Like maybe you're thinking of Dune, where, and this was in Frank Herbert's science fiction novel, they had a rule, thou shalt make no machine in the image of the human mind. And in the name of this rule, they had destroyed all computers. And consequently, they were telepathic and they had powers of language and telepathy. But on the other hand, it was a startlingly primitive world. I mean, our thing is not, I don't think we can, our machines are such a basic part of our cultural toolbox now. For instance, you know, the world price of gold is set every day by machines. The decisions of to how much titanium and silver should be extracted from mines to enter the pipeline of the manufacturing process, this is all determined by machines. Now in Silicon Valley, when they want to design a chip with to meet certain engineering specifications, they don't design the architecture of the chip, they tell machines what they want the chip to do, and machines actually make the design decisions. So, but I don't find this horrifying at all. I mean, I remember in the 50s, one of the fantasies was that we would, in the future, we would live in a world run by machines. Well, instead we live in a world run by politicians, mafias, advertising conspiracies, pharmaceutical companies, and political pressure groups. I'd take machines any day against that crowd and their wonderful impartiality. And, yeah.
I mean, that when listening, that's the question I ask myself, is this radical change of psychology
mm-hmm.
with the power base, with our concept of what power is, our egos hanging on. Is it the return to this pre-ego state with a technology to assist us?
In a sense, I think it is, because I think you're right, that power has always before meant ideology. The Christians had the power, or the Marxists had the power, or the Nazis, or the communists. Now, I feel like we have come to the end of ideology. That the bankruptcy of ideology is displayed for all to see, and that the business of government and destiny, which used to be in the hands of ideologues, has moved over into the hands of managers. And it's all become rather humdrum. It's all about, you know, will the investment policies support the health care promises made to the population? Will the production of drugs meet the demands created by the ebb and flow of epidemic diseases? It's all about management. I think our exhaustion with ideology is very healthy. I don't think there are good and bad ideologies. All ideology is bad, and it's taken us, you know, 1,000 years to sort this out, and we had to have Auschwitz, and we had to have Stalingrad, and we had to have, just how many times did you have to have your nose rubbed in it before you realize, you know, that ideologies are cultural memes. They are the most confining of the cultural memes. I mean, that's where culture gets real ugly, is when you rub up against its ideologies. So by turning a lot of these middle management and bureaucratic functions over to machines, we're signaling that we're not interested in that anymore.
And yet the ego, I see ego as alive and well as it's ever been in my lifetime.
Well, ego is not the same thing as ideology. I agree with you. What we now have, and this is this question that keeps coming up in so many different forms, what we now have is the freedom which attends decadence, or the decadence which attends freedom. By being liberated from ideology, we essentially are invited to be all we can be, but we are free, in James Joyce's phrase, to flop on the seamy side. And, you know, without Christianity, without democracy, without, you know, these great inspiring... And so this is the question, why does all freedom end in sadomasochism? Why do all efforts at liberation end in recidivism and repression? Is this a natural law, or is this, we've had a bad string of experiences with this, but it's not writ in adamantine? I for me, it's an issue of, are we afraid of ourselves? And we inherit a huge bunch of ideological baggage, not only Christianity, but Freudianism and Marxism, which requires, you know, a dictatorship of the proletariat and so forth and so on. We inherit all kinds of ideological baggage designed to make us fear ourselves. I mean, what is held against any theory of excess freedom is that it will bring chaos and anarchy. Well, this may be precisely what the doctor ordered. Beyond ideology lies chaos and anarchy. The fact that the internet is so chaotic is, I think, its great charm. It seems like a frontier, you know, no law west of the modem yet, and hopefully not for a while. I mentioned in another context, but not to this group, but I guess this is in the air, this French historian, and I don't know exactly how to pronounce his name, but Raoul Vanegan, who wrote this thing called The Brotherhood, The Movement of the Free Spirit. And it discusses a heresy that had great currency in the Middle Ages. And the heresy had many names and different forms, but it always revolved around the proclamation that human beings are perfect. Human beings are perfect. And it was fascinating to feel my own reactions as I read this, because I certainly am, I don't consider myself Catholic in reflex, and I'm trying to be a good anarchist, and I lean toward the idea that man is perfect. But reading about a group of people who absolutely believed and acted this out pushes you up against it. Because, you know, if man is perfect, theft is all right, murder is all right, murder of your own children is all right, on and on and on. So then you think, well, then, so apparently I don't think man is perfect. Well, then, so where do I draw the line? The fact that people in the 1200s could make this leap to proclaim this and then to live it. They lived it. So they didn't work and they didn't stay in the villages, and no one would have anything to do with them except people who agreed with them. And so there were these, there was this counterculture in medieval Europe of these large camps of people outside major towns where everybody who was there by being there was committed to the idea that anyone could have sex with anyone else, that anyone could take anything by anyone else and use it as their own, that no one had to answer to anyone else, that there was no authority, so forth and so on. Well, the church burned these people with endless zeal, you can imagine. And even for us, reading this, it shows you how deeply we carry the idea of our shadow and how profoundly convinced we are that we pose a great danger to each other and that we must mitigate this with law and rules and psychotherapy and drugs and high walls and so forth and so on. This bombing of these airplanes and then the Olympics and the stuff on and on and on is so clearly designed to replace the rather, I imagine, unviolent and humdrum world you live in. I mean, when was the last time you saw several people blown apart by plastique? Not recently, I'm willing to bet, unless you just shipped in from Algeria. But you're asked to give up your experience and replace it with a media created world of exploding airliners, sinister international organizations, and so forth and so on. This ability to use the deaths of what are trivial numbers of people, I mean, in the same week that these 200 people were blown out of the sky, 6,000 people died on the American highways, and there was not a mention of that. So the exaggerated focus on certain situations and the deaths of certain designated high-profile groups of people permits an incredible paranoia and an incredible erosion of any effort to create community. This is these are decisions not made by machines. Machines would never act with so deep an insight into human psychology. These are decisions initiated by human managers playing the old style game.
Well, it's not just. It doesn't seem like it's not just managers, designers, individuals who love this kind of news, whose favorite type of entertainment that they pay to see is these violent movies of people being blown up.
Well, we are all guilty to the degree that we tolerate and consume this stuff. Prurience has always been the path to riches. Was it P.T. Barnum who said nobody ever went broke underestimating the taste of the American people? I'm sure that that's quite true.
So to what do you ascribe this desire that seems to arouse from individuals?
Well, I personally, and I'm willing to extend it to my friends and my enemies, I personally do not enjoy seeing violence or people being tormented or children being abused or this sort of thing. When I was in Boulder, I met a friend of mine that I hadn't seen for 25 years and asked him what he was up to. And what he's doing is he's founded a company called Rocky Mountain Media Watch. And what they do is they have 150 people who work for them in 150 cities. And once a week, these people make a video cassette off the TV of the evening news, the local evening news hour. And they ship all these tapes to Boulder, and they have rooms full of people watching these things on screens and scoring how much of this hour went to ecological stories, how much went to lost pet stories, how much went to toxic waste stories, how much went to the circuses in town stories. And I said, well, Paul, what is the deal with violence and what's going on? And he said, whoa, it's very simple. We've seen it thousands and thousands of times. In a half-hour show, the most violent part of the show occurs immediately before the longest commercial. Mm-hmm. And you are brought to this state of adrenal excitement. And I said, well, do people enjoy watching people shot and blown up? And he said, no, you can put electrodes on them and you can tell that it raises anxiety and it raises adrenaline levels. But he said, the whole point is then you cut to the commercial, you bring on images of sexuality, of flesh, of soft music, and of the product. And the product then becomes associated with a security. It's all about, look at this horrible death, manglement, horror, now, and this wonderful soap which will give you social confidence and make your hair shiny and your underarms inoffensive. And this game is played 300 or 400 times a night, with monkeys on the receiving end, you know, people who you know, take Ross Perot seriously and fear visits by alien proctologists, that population are, you know, being subject to this hammering stimulus response thing. Well, it's no wonder that people are just totally clueless. The cultural engines are becoming almost unmanageably dangerous for the unsophisticated. This is what I meant last night when I said there are two kinds of people. There are artists and marks. Not in a tone of superiority, we're the artists and we're on the inside and so we're immune and the marks, fuck them, they're all lost souls. No, every one of us every day is tested to see, are you an artist or are you a mark? In this moment, are you an artist or are you a mark? In this situation, are you an artist or are you a mark? And, you know, everybody tumbles both ways several times a day. I don't know exactly what to do about it. I mean, Joseph Goebbels really turned it loose inside the 20th century. I mean, this has all been developed since the 30s, you know, advertising techniques of behavior modification, ways of insinuating complex messages into people and getting them to respond. The antidote is, in that environment, you cannot flee from it. You cannot avoid it. What you have to do is produce output, into this ocean of competing means, output and subversion and sophistication. You have to be, I think, very, very... this is no environment for the credulous, the epistemologically naive, those driven by inner imbalances to adoration and belief. I mean, I really believe, I think I said last night, salvation through skepticism, hope through skepticism. Because it's too difficult to tell what's going on. The only reliable indicators in this world are feelings and mathematics. And mathematics has been torn from you as an option in the process of infantilization that we're denouncing here. So all you have left are your feelings, 90% of us.